Hi, everybody, and welcome to today's panel discussion on filmmaking as a tool for environmentalism. For those of you who are new to ALLDEF stands for All Living Things Environmental Film Festival, and is a platform for mobilizing and inspiring people to co-create sustainable futures, both locally and at large. So I'm really excited to be introducing this panel discussion. I'm sure that everybody attending this panel loves films and cares about the environment. And so we know that films are a powerful medium to inspire action. And they also have such an amazing potential at also captivating the imagination. So when it comes to environmental films, the big question is, what impact do they really have? And what are some of the challenges and also the opportunities that come with making environmental films today? So I'm really happy to introduce our moderator for today, Shubhani Chaudhary, who's executive director at Dusty Foot Foundation. She's worked on several films, award-winning films with colleagues Mike Pandey and Rita Banerjee. She also has worked on various issues related to wildlife conservation and communities. Shubhani is also really passionate about encouraging youth to take action on issues to do with the environment. So with that, I will hand over the mic, so to speak, to Shubhani. And in the meantime, I just want to just quickly share a few links to let people know. The deadline for submitting your film for the festival is on the 15th of September, so that's just 9 days from now. I'm just going to put those in the chat, but I can talk a little bit more about that later.
So should we go ahead, Francesca?
Yes, Shubhani.
Great. So thanks, Francesca, and hi, everyone. Thank you, ALLDEF, for getting us all together. And thank all of you in the audience for joining us today. So today's session, filmmaking as a tool for environmentalism, is actually a part of the key aspects of our day-to-day life. So it isn't something just assigned to a few hallowed people who are going into the forest and doing these films, but it's a key aspect of each of our day-to-day lives because it involves communication, it involves the framework that we all live in, which is nature and the planet, which is not separate from us and what we live and breathe every day, and the capacity for each of us to influence and call to action and take action as a part of human society. So today we are here to discuss the power of the visual medium and the power that actually moves people and brings change. So if you really go back, some of the iconic photographs taken from space were Earthrise and Blue Marble. These were taken in the late 60s, early 70s, and in some ways, they taught human beings to look at the world as a whole, the planet as a whole. And somewhere, perhaps, what we call environmentalism today and what we are here to discuss started with that idea that it is all one big planet and we are a part of it. So in terms of protecting this planet, as we are going to be discussing today, one of the key people to flag planetary emergency for climate action is Al Gore, as we all know. And Davis Guggenheim's film, An Inconvenient Truth, tells the story of this crusade. All political aspects apart, it is an important document on what was done as a flagship effort to bring climate change into public domain. And while critiquing it, the Empire magazine reviewed it as powerful, intelligent, and surprisingly entertaining. Gore presents a compelling case. And here's the punchline, you will believe a film can change the world, right? So that's what we are here to discuss. And in fact, I was reminded of this film while talking about this session to Maya Chaudhary, who herself is a national award winning teacher. And she mentioned how Al Gore's climate emergency message remained with her thanks to this film. So be it an astronaut taking a photograph, a politician, a failed one at that, a filmmaker, a teacher, urban youth, tribal youth, farmers, journalists, wildlife biologists, or forest guards. As they say, it takes a village. and an unlikely thread for this interdisciplinary, intersectoral connect is actually the visual medium. So we are really happy to have with us three very experienced and interesting panelists who will share their perspective and journey with us today. So thank you again. And I'll start by introducing Mandakini Mathur. She is a filmmaker, storyteller, poet, scriptwriter, and the founder of Devrai Arts Village in Panchgani, Maharashtra. Mandakini studied at the Sorbonne University, Paris, and has made films exploring the man-nature connect and Indian culture and spirituality. She interacts with school children using filmmaking and theater as a means of creative expression and exploration. And she has also created audiovisual resource material for teaching English communication skills for vernacular medium schools based on these stories. Her vision for Devrai Art Village is to connect with nature, celebrate creativity, sustain Adivasi livelihood, and support the heritage of indigenous art and craft. So we are very happy to have with us Mandakini. And I'll now introduce Rita Banerjee. She is the founder director of the Green Hub Project, which is a collaboration between the Northeast Network and Dusty Foot. This leverages the power of youth in conservation action and social change through the power of the visual medium. Rita is one of the leading environmental filmmakers in India and has been a part of three Wildscreen Panda award-winning films, also known as the Green Oscars. This includes The Shores of Silence, Whale Sharks in India, and The Wild Made Trail. In 2017, Rita was awarded the National Geographic CMS Prithvi Ratna Award for contribution to environment through films and the RBS Earth Heroes Award in 2018. In 2019, she was inducted as an Ashoka Fellow. Rita believes in collaborations and works closely with youth and communities to bring forth stories from the ground, to create alternate and aspirational livelihood opportunities at the local level while generating ecological and conservation security. Gautam Pandey is the director of Riverbank Studios. He's a young and very accomplished wildlife filmmaker, well known from India. He studied film in Canada and has won several national and international awards for his films, including the National Award. Gautam lives with a passion for the wild. Born into a family of nature enthusiasts, his passion for filmmaking started at an early age, and he is now focused on using film as a medium to bring about awareness about wildlife and combine the genres of natural history and conservation films. Two of his films on air are on Animal Planet and Discovery, Gyamo, Queen of the Mountains, and Looking for Sultan. Both films have been awarded internationally and recognized for their conservation message. So as you can see from these brief bios that these are three people with a very diverse but very focused interests on linking their lives and their expertise with nature and the environment and people. So I'm going to ask each of them to introduce themselves briefly, and more their work briefly, and if possible, if time allows us, to show us a little bit of their work on video. So Mandakini, I request you to go first, and then Rita and Gautam. Thank you so much.
Hello. Hello, everybody. At the outset, I would like to say that for me, filmmaking wasn't a conscious choice of a career, but I was lured into it by the forests in Mahabaleshwar. Yeah, it all started when we shifted from Panchgani to Mahabaleshwar, and from Mumbai to Mahabaleshwar to Panchgani, and with a borrowed camcorder and Dikshit sir as my guide, my mentor, I started exploring the forests of Mahabaleshwar. And filmmaking for me was a means of connecting with nature, observing nature, capturing the moments. Like we discovered the source of Koina, the blooming of Karvi, watching the change of seasons and all that. So that's how I got into filmmaking. Otherwise, I've done my post-graduation in film as a subject from Sorbonne. So I understood, I saw the power of this medium. And my first film, in fact, was on the practice of burning the hill slopes. Because, you know, when soon after the winter and the beginning of spring, what I noticed was all these hills were getting charred. And so just curiosity, and then I started talking to the villagers and find out their compulsions or why were they burning all this? And then understood their side. And this film then was translated in Marathi. And the forest department used it as a means to create a dialogue with the village community. And we had a very nice forest officer, very conscientious. And so a dialogue between the forest department and the community, who are always at loggerheads with each other, was created through the medium of the film. So this is how I understood the power of film, that to reach to the masses. And if you want to tell something, it's such a powerful medium, and it tugs at your heartstrings. And that was the same time I had started teaching. I was interacting with the school children, and I was doing actually communication skills using filmmaking and theater as a means to for the students to hone their communication skills and to be able to express, so as a means of creative expression, as well as telling their own stories. And we started making child-centric themes based on child-centric issues. So the first film I made with them, I remember, was ads and food fads. So just this was about the ads lure you into eating junk food and what it does to your bodies and all. So with the children, I made this film, and the process of filmmaking itself told them, was an eye-opener for them to the manipulative ads and all. And it was a great success. Like at the end of the film, we even, dipped the tooth of a child and saw how Coca-Cola would corrode it, and all this was documented. And then this film became a good resource material to generate discussions among people, not just about the effect of junk food on their bodies and their minds, but as an attitude to consumerism, an attitude to life, and what do plastics and how it is not just filling up the earth and creating pollution, but also polluting the bodies and the mind. And another film which I made with the children, just to cite two examples, was A Classroom of Flowers. So very close to Panchkani is the famous Kas Plateau, famous for its wildflowers, and it's a World Heritage Site. But the children who are cocooned in their schools rarely get an opportunity to observe the change of nature or to explore the forest. What they learn is from the books. And I as a teacher, I realized, because that's what I was myself understanding with this camcorder, that, you know, how it enlivens your senses, the act of filmmaking, and you experience it better rather than getting information from the books. You are living those experiences. So again, we went to Kas and we recorded the blooming of the flowers, and just the message that knowledge is love. And where environmental this thing is concerned, it has to tug at the heartstrings. No amount of preaching, no amount of telling will have the same impact. So it was all about creating inspiring which awareness, which inspires them into action in their own ways, in their lives, not just talking about bigger issues of climate change, and yes, but at their level. And for that, I found filmmaking very, very effective. At the same time, now in the end, I would just like to share my personal journey. So that was the time I got an opportunity to make a film for the film's division, a documentary on River Krishna. So I traveled from here, from Mahabaleshwar, where it starts, across the subcontinent to Machilipatnam, where it meets the Bay of Bengal. And this whole journey, I understood how it was like exploring within and without. So it was not just a journey into the past, but into the present. And that's where I found out how the river was like a sutra, and underlying the substratum of varied culture which our country has, varied faiths, and how we worship river, how we Indians actually worship nature. We see God permeating nature as the body of God, but we have forgotten when you know, we don't take care of it. We have forgotten the meaning behind the rituals. And I thought if we could tap into this latent energy of faith, it can move. Even the, like they say, faith moves mountains. So in fact, I made a short film, Faith Moves Rivers, because, do we have little time to show this little two TV spots which we made, which will speak about what I'm trying to say, because it's in our culture, it's in our genes, but we have forgotten this. So film as a medium to sensitize people to our own values, to our own culture, which we have lost, and it has just degenerated into mere ritualism. So there's two TV spots, if we have time, we could show, which shows how we venerate rivers. The river washes your soul, but how about cleaning the river is the last final ironic message of the film.
Thank you, Mandakini. So thank you. We can just quickly look at the videos. Thanks, Mandakini.
कहीं हम उसकी उतारे आरती, कहीं हम उसे पहनाए साड़ी, करते हैं हम नदी की पूजा, मानते हैं पानी को तीर्थ, नदी हमारे धोए पाप, पर नदी को नहलाए कौन, नदी को स्वच्छ रखना ही है उसकी पूजा, आकाश से उतरती गंगा संभाले कौन इसके वेग को, तब शिवजी ने समेटा इसे अपनी घनी जटाओं में, भोले शंकर की जटाएं ये पेड़ नहीं तो और क्या है, धरती की गोद में ले आते हैं संभाल के आकाश से गंगा, पेड़ की केवल पूजा नहीं, पेड़ की रक्षा ही है जल का जीवन,
थैंक यू मंदाकिनी, थैंक यू गौतम फॉर प्लेइंग द वीडियो. And we'll take forward the conversation afterwards in the session. I request Rita to please present your work and show us a clip if you have one. Thanks.
Mute.
Myself. Can you guys hear me? Yeah. Thank you, Altef, for inviting me to this forum, and really happy to be part of this. And I think a lot of what Mandakini said, I resonate a lot with that, the power of the visual medium as such. So I've been in environment filmmaking for more than 20 years, maybe more than 25 years now. And I think with every year, the idea that video is a very strong tool for conservation, that has only grown stronger. And there's another aspect which has been very important, is that it's been a huge teacher I'm concerned. Like everything about India, everything about environment, everything about the interaction of humans with wildlife, with the ecosystem, or what India is as a whole, has been through the medium of films. And it's been an amazing journey. It's been like watching the honey hunters, you know, hang down these cliffs, just like long cliffs with forest vines trying to harvest the rock bee honey. or you know, waiting on the beach all night for many days, just watching the leatherback come up on the beach just to lay eggs. And these moments, I mean, I think they're just lifetime moments which remain with you and which make you kind of convinced that, you know, that's the reason you need to protect everything which we have, every bit of forest, every bit of river, every bit of the knowledge that people have. And for me as a filmmaker, one of the films which was a very, very important turning point was a film called The Wild Meat Trail. I'll just share some of the images from there. Can you all see the images? Yeah. So this is almost like, this is in 2007. And this film we did over almost 5 years. And this is a group of Nishi tribesmen. And they had in fact banned hunting. They had banned hunting, but they took us to the forest to kind of show us the kind of traps they were using, or the kind of you know, things they used to use for hunting. But the most beautiful part of that entire journey of staying with them in the forest was the kind of knowledge which they had. You know, like the forest was really like their home. They knew every nook and corner, the plants which they were using, the squirrel where it was nesting. And they just needed a dhow to set up a camp, to catch fish. And I think that's what, when you spend time with them, all the things about, you know, what a forest really means came down. And this is a very favorite image of mine. This is Jarjo, one of the guys who took us to the forest. And he just took our camera and he said, why don't you guys sit in the village? And, you know, we'll do the filming for you. And I think these were like, you know, some of the thoughts which kind of take root and say, why not actually, you know? And so from there, this film kind of pushed us to say that, yes, films are a powerful tool. And if they can be combined actually with conservation action on the ground, then it can be amplified. And we started with a very small project after the film called Under the Canopy, which was just working with children and trying to make them, this is in Nagaland, and this is with a group called Northeast Network, who I still continue to work with. And there were children from the village who used to hunt, who eat wild meat. And suddenly when they looked through the binoculars, you know, the same bird which they hunted suddenly came alive for them. And I still remember the reaction of the kids and saying, whoa, you know, and it kind of started changing the perception about wildlife around them. The value of a frog, the value of a butterfly, or linked to the water, connected to them, you know. And this is like one of the moments where we set up the moth screen and hundreds of moths came alive. And these are the things which kind of made us believe that, yes, you can use video, you can use photography to start changing mindsets over time, you know, and directly working with the community. But the whole question remained that, how do you scale up conservation? I mean, if you look at what is happening around us, all our efforts together have to really amplify, have to really scale up to make a dent or make a change towards conservation. And this is what, this is a thought which kind of pushed us to start Green Hub, which kind of involves youth in conservation, but using video as a base. So this is what it is. I'll just share some images from there. Every year we take on 20 youth from across the Northeast region and they stay with us for 1 year. And in that 1 year, they kind of travel to the field, they document even amongst the community. Most of them belong to the indigenous communities. Most of them belong to remote parts. They still, their basic knowledge about environment is much more than me even today, like, you know. And so for them, the camera becomes an extra tool, you know, to document that bird, to document that person in the village who has the knowledge. And it's been 5 years now. There are more than 88 fellows now. And they're spread across the region. And these are just some images. Seetal, she's a Nishi girl from Arunachal, works with Nature Conservation Foundation. This is Zakuma, who works with the forest patrolling team. So it's kind of something which it's becoming a collective, which is not just the fellows, but also the kind of resource people we have, who kind of add to the thought process, who add to the network, who add to the collective voice for conservation. And I think at the end of it, what the whole definition of conservation, when we are looking at the films at the end of the year, it's not conservation in isolation. It's not environment in isolation that you have to go to forest and film wildlife. It's the village stories, it's the gender stories, it's the medicinal plants, it's the folk music. And that is what is, I think, key to what we are all trying to do, break the silos, you know, bring everybody together where conservation is actually the umbrella of what we are talking about. And that's where the films really, really help in breaking those barriers. And at the end of it, what is it that really kind of raises the hope that maybe, yes, all our efforts will move towards the right direction? And from films, really changing the things on the ground. So these are some examples from the field. This is Wanmer in Mon district. After Green Hub, he set up something called the Biodiversity Management Committee. And today, he's selected an area in the village and the entire community is coming together to restore the thing. So while it started with a small visual clip and him using the camera, today he's changing the entire dialogue on conservation in this area. These three are Surly Bon, Joyhind, and Moniram. They work in Karbi Anglong. This is the largest district in Assam. And the thing is that this is an area which is mining is one of the things which is coming up. Rubber plantations are there. And these three in different parts of Karbi Anglong are trying to get everybody together, trying to, it's all community forest, trying to bring together people to start thinking of conservation. And all of them use the video also to document what is happening in the field. So there are similar stories across where these fellows are becoming actually the change makers. You know, they are becoming the change makers for their region. They're trying to help build the region back. But the most beautiful thing I think which has happened is that now there's a collective, a network of youth across this region who are not just the fellows, but are helping to connect many, 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 many groups to raise awareness on conservation, raise awareness on the issues which are happening there. So that is where the whole power of video, I think, takes on another role. And I think also they're totally breaking the way or showing us ways of which films can be shown in remote areas. And this is a favorite image of mine where one of the fellows took his film back to his grandmother. He was filming on shifting on the traditional agriculture. And he took the film back, put it on a tripod. His grandmother and rest of the community sat and gave feedback on, okay, this is okay and this is not okay. And the whole process becomes a participatory process, you know? So I think with this, if there is time, we can play the promo. Otherwise, we can share the link on the chat. Thank you so much. I'll just stop the sharing one.
So
should we play the promo?
Yeah, we could play that, Gautam, and then we'll move to your film and your story.
I just have an Instagram account. I really don't have much to say after that. So one sec, just share screen.
Oh,
Thank you. Thank you, Gautam, for playing it. Thank you, Rita, for that presentation and the clip by the Green Hub Fellows. Very inspiring. And now we have Gautam, who is somebody who's shot above the snow line, uses high-end equipment, but ends up, using it to tell stories of nature. And I request you, Gautam, to tell us your story and show us the clip that you have chosen to share with us.
Well, thank you for having me. Great to be part of this panel. Amazing to hear everyone's stories. And I have a special connect with Shibani and Rita as well over here. And I mentioned that in the few slides that I have. And always great to see the Green Hub stuff. I mean, I'm familiar with it, but every time I see it, I still get like wowed by it. And I think what really hits home for me is that you see people telling their own stories. And I think that's very hard to recreate or replace. And that's the magic. You don't have to be a trained filmmaker or have a degree to be an environmentalist. And I think that's what I'm going to lean into. So it was going to be a talk and show a little video or whatever, but I think I need those plates to kind of put it in front of me. So I'll share the screen and I'll just go through this. So, I mean, I was trying to get my thoughts going. So I just Googled environmentalism. And it's got this really dry and stale kind of definition, concern about an action aimed at protecting the environment. And I think I fell asleep right after that. And it's just, I mean, who would want to be an environmentalist after reading that? So then I Googled and I said, environmentalism is, and this is what it said. And it was a bit shocking as well. It's a luxury of the rich, it's a religion, Quizlet, elitist awakening for. And then I Googled environmentalists are, and this is what it said, a wrong hypocrites earnestly trying to determine. And I think a lot of the important work that happened, it was pushed so hard, like all of it, say no to plastic or save our oceans. And it's been decades and decades of it. But this, it's sad to see if this is the end result or this is what Google thinks it is. Environmentalists are stricter controls. And I mean, that's completely current, with all the issues that are going on in India related directly to, development and all the infrastructure plans. So I've tried to figure out who are these environmentalists who are, these squares. So these are the environmentalists that Google threw up. These are the environmentalist filmmakers. And they kind of look like they're all hanging out at the same party. And again, this felt a bit revealing as well. I mean, most of them seem to be men. And I was just kind of thinking of, I thought after decades and so much, work put in by people all over the world, I thought Greta Thunberg would show up for sure in this list, in the first four quarters at least, but she's not here. Then I did top documentaries on Netflix, and these are the ones that came up. And this is revealing. This is something that I always struggle with, because by the end of it, and this is my own theory in the making, is that everyone just wants to be entertained, including me. And raise your hand if you're binge watching Cobra Kai right now or Indian Matchmaking. Did that in one night. But I mean, these are very watchable, very entertaining. Tiger King, people thought was a wildlife kind of a series, but it's basically a true crime genre. Out of all of these that you see, Our Planet is the only one which is sort of a bit wildlife related, but that comes under the category of blue chip, which is really high-end, images and visuals from across the planet of wildlife, which takes millions and millions of pounds and dollars to find and create. So they have like gigantic teams and they film for years and they get these visuals which are just absolutely stunning. And it's great, but it also gives you the feeling that, okay, things are still okay. I don't need to panic yet. So let me get back to, the last episode of Tiger King or whatever. It's changing a bit. the new series, Our Planet, they spoke a bit about conservation, but I still feel like it's not direct enough, it's not hard enough. The old feeling was that we need to make people fall in love with nature and the environment, and then they'll want to protect it. And what I think is that, I think that process is done. People know, people do care to a certain degree, maybe not enough. A lot of times people don't know what to do or where to go. And these are the blue chip films. And if you see these look like film posters, like proper. And again, these have almost all of them, I think, have giant budgets. I'm trying to see if there's a low budget one in here somewhere. It's all in millions, of course, or hundreds and thousands of dollars. I don't know, maybe The Biggest Little Farm. I haven't seen that one, but that might be Before the Flood is sort of a more of a documentary. And that's the only one out of all of these, I think, which is sort of addresses environmental issues directly. But that again was totally funded, backed by big money, star value, Leonardo DiCaprio. And that's what they were most excited by, was that it had star power behind it. Not that it was really speaking about issues. So, you know, as a filmmaker, you go out and you try and document amazing stuff. And, you know, I want to take those pretty images too. And, you know, some amazing stuff wherever I go and see. But this is where I think the road split between trying to make amazing films where everyone says, oh, wow, you know, I want to do what you're doing. Oh, you know, your job is the coolest. You see all this cool stuff. You do. But very often, and I would say almost every time, there's just much more to it than what the lens is capturing. So these are a few shots that I took, just, I think most of them are from my phone, except the tiger one and the snow leopard one. So I think it starts with the caterpillar that's somewhere in the northeast. Oh, it starts with the tiger one. So it's the tiger, but this is Ranthambore. This is the areas outside around Ranthambore. And there's quarrying happening there. That was in the Western Ghats. There's road widening, all kinds of stuff going on there, destruction. Turtles coming to nest, but there's drift nets. There's all kinds of other issues which affect them. That's in the Northeast, in Manipur, in Mizoram, sorry. And it's a cute image at first looks, but this bear was orphaned because the mother was hunted. And then she was being raised by the forest department, and then she was later released, but never, you know, I think the proper process was not followed for rewilding her. So she was completely habituated to humans, and then she got poached, of course. And then the snow leopard. Oh, no, then the pitcher plant. And that was in Indonesia, and there are just, it's quite something. As far as the eye can see, it's like looking at the ocean. If you've, I'm sure most of us have been to the ocean, is literally like looking at the ocean, and it's all plantation. And it's very, very scary to look at. And snow leopards in Ladakh, and that is what I believe is the highest landfill in India. So, you know, this is an image from Shores of Silence, and this is where, you know, I feel it's a special panel for me with Shibani and Rita. This is a film that they were making with my father, and I was, you know, reading Archie comics or Twinkle or whatever it was back then. But this was a turning point in my life because I saw them doing their thing, and I knew what environmentalist filmmakers look like. You know, you've seen that Google image I showed you guys and what kind of lives they have. But this film made real impact. And I think that was a lesson that I quietly learned watching From the Shadows, watching these guys really put themselves out there, think beyond themselves and create impact. I mean, I won't go on about it. Google the film Shores of Silence and you'll get more information on it. So I've been trying to use technology to try and create impact in the same way and reach people and kind of change perceptions. And VR is one of them, 360. And I was back in Ladakh to try and retell some stories. So that's a 360 camera. And what I'll do is I'll show you what 360 images look like finally when you put them on a headphone, on a headset with headphones. So you can look around wherever because it's 360. And There you go. And suddenly there's a snow leopard next to you. And so this has great impact. And what also has great impact is one sec. So the pity visuals have impact, but so do the nasty images. So there's that same landfill, but in 360, it just had a much, much deeper impact. I had shown those visuals before. I had made a short film out of it as well, but people were shocked. They were horrified, but they weren't stunned into silence, I think. But with 360, and make them feel like they're in the middle of this mountain of plastic bottles, most of it, of course, created by tourism. And if you've been to Ladakh, you have contributed to this pile 100%. This, I think, created that impact. And that is something which is that lesson which I learned from Rita and Shabani and my father, and that's what I'm trying to carry on. And I think that's why I'm making films still. That's it.
Thank you, Gautam. That was very telling. And I think the starting with his Google searches was a stroke of genius and really shows you what in perspective, what environmentalists and environmentalisms are kind of cocooned into a corner of the reality of the world. So thank you for bringing that to us. Do we have, we are kind of running short of time, but maybe we should just see a clip of your Gyamo. Just, would you like to share it or do you feel the 360 and all has given us a sense of it already?
Yeah, I think it's fine. We can sort of Google it.
Yeah, so Gyamo and the Green Hub promos, and I think Mandakini's work is also all online. I think the Alt-F team will share the links. So anyone in the audience who wants to see the full film and look at the work deeper, please do have a look at the sites that our panelists work and connect with, and you'll be able to trace those films there. So we don't have much time, but and so perhaps we'll cut short the journeys of why you were drawn to this and all the personal stuff. But I think what would be important for us to really look at is coming together with the three presentations that all of you have made with your work. What is it? And I'll put this question to Mandakini, that when you work with children, Mandakini, and if you could just be a little brief because we're running into the last 15 minutes of our session. So when you work with children, what is the connect? Do you feel that they have a link with nature, or do you feel you need to generate that connect? Because we've heard from Rita's presentation how they've been able to work with the kids in the Northeast, and kids who would destroy a butterfly now are learning to photograph it. But here in central India and the Western Ghats, what is your connect with the children? Are you needing to build that? Do they have that, what you term as nature deficit disorder, or are they easy to link back to nature? So
my interaction with kids from mainstream school is very different from those with Adivasi apprentices and I'm working with. So mainstream school, they actually don't know much about what the need for conservation. It seems like a romantic, indulgent kind of a thought. They feel like they want to do something, but when it, Gautam said, that they don't know what to do. So how to get connected with this movement. You're overwhelmed with the desire to do. And at the same time, our environmental studies as a subject is really dreadful. So you need to make that bridge between what is taught and, experiential learning. Whereas with Adivasi apprentices who come to learn basically craft and all, I'm right now training them into filmmaking because they're often the object of study. And I thought stories coming from them will be more authentic. And filmmaking is such a medium that they could use it. It's like, it reminded me of Camera Stilo, the movement Nouvelle Vague, when you use a camera like a pen. So they are not good with language, spoken or written language, or communicating through language. But if they want to report their own stories, their realities, it is more authentic if we train them into being filmmakers rather than make films on them. Of course, I mean, both can happen simultaneously. And so this is what I would like to share, that filmmaking is really a very potent medium to be used, and both for their indigenous knowledge systems, which are just being forgotten, so much to learn from them rather than teaching. And their aspirations are changing. We must keep that in mind, not remain in that world that tribals are the custodians of forests, or, you know, I think without exaggeration, the Forest Rights Act is the last nail on the coffin of conservation. Because these tribals who had no idea of private property, now they are being given private this thing. And what happens is that it gets sold. They sell it, and you read, I mean, when there's poverty and there's nothing, it's natural for them to fall prey to this. So what are we doing to them? We're not helping them. We are turning them into poachers and, you know, things like that. So we have to create livelihoods which are culturally aligned to their this thing, not teach them computers and this thing, but let them be, and because we need to learn. So that's what Devrai Art Village, the NGO, which I started 10 years ago, is trying to create, that bridge between far-flung tribal areas and the mainstream.
Thank you. Thank you, Mandakini. And you've raised an important issue also about tribal context and new, focus areas, especially tribal youth who want to become part of the mainstream, feel they need to break away from their roots. And Rita, I'd leave this question with you, that when you worked, it's a very, very complex tapestry of different kinds of communities all across the northeastern states and parts of central India where you'll be working and where you have worked. How is it that you found when communities respond to where traditionally they have practiced hunting? And this was also a question from the audience, that how do they balance hunting as a traditional practice and the idea of conservation today? What did you find with the communities? What are they willing to take forward in a sustainable, optional way?
I think it's not a very easy answer in that sense, but if you look at the larger system, what one has found really missing is what Mandakini was also saying, is the way the education system kind of talks about development, talks about livelihood, and talks about employment opportunities. There's a huge disconnect between what is being taught in colleges, schools, even at the rural level, even at the small town level, to what the future is. And many of the youth who come for the applications, you know, they're just coming looking for opportunities. And they finish their college, there's a degree. You know, even from the most remote areas, they'll come to the small town and have a degree. But after the degree, it's an absolute blank. And that's why you have a lot of migration into the cities. And many of them come back. Many of them come back because they've been taught that there's a disconnect between development and protecting your natural resources. But as soon as that opportunity or the connection is made, there are enough youth who take that up and see they don't want to leave their region. They don't want to leave their forest. They don't want to, as long as you really connect that to conservation and livelihood. You cannot cut livelihood out of it. But the definition of livelihood has to change. And I think if you look at COVID right now, it's a stark example of how the development model has failed. Why are people coming back to the roots? You know, so I think what needs to be done is that it needs to be scaled up for sure. You know, and we need to work harder at creating opportunities that look at sustenance through protecting your natural resources. You know, there has to be a balance. I'm not saying don't have the roads, don't have the hospitals, don't have the education. All that is required. Every remote village of our country should have the internet, should have computers, should have education. But that does not mean that you have to destroy the forest. That does not mean that you have to build a dam. That does not mean that, you know, go for this green energy. There are many other things which are coming up. It's about the governance trying to change the mindset. So I think I have seen that. I mean, the youth are the ones who are taking the entire movement ahead here. You know, everybody, not just, you know, the fellows, but everybody's raising the voice across the country, and it's the youth. So one has to see that.
So, and to take further this point, Rita, what about the idea of traditional knowledge? One is youth connecting back to their resources and their context, their tribal context, and their, but what about traditional knowledge? Is there a continuity in that? Is there a generational transfer of that knowledge that is happening, or is there a rupture, or are the kind of efforts that you're making with the youth there, is it?
I think all of us working in the field of films, whether it's Mandakini, whether it's Gautam, whether it's me, I think it's as soon as you give a camera in somebody's hand and they go and interview somebody older in their village, it really helps to bridge that gap. You know, they may not have had conversations with their grandfather or their grandmothers earlier, but the camera is a very beautiful tool to bridge that gap. And I think as soon as that world opens up, you know, it becomes a very good connect between the past and what needs to be done for the future. I think both need to be looked at in a how you can use the past and how you can take it in the future. I mean, using, like Gautam is using 360 as such a beautiful tool for the future, you know? So it has to be a combination of preserving the past and taking it into the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Mandakini and Rita, for that perspective. Gautam, I'd like you to marry what we've heard from both of them with your knowledge, because some of your productions are, the grand, big ticket, 4K, good equipment kind of thing. And in your presentation, you did share that you don't need to be a trained filmmaker, but there is something to be said for that grand scale of filmmaking. What is your experience in that? And using the digital medium in a hardcore sense in the future, you know, because youth are connected to this digital generation. What is your perspective on it, and how can we link this digital movement into conservation and make it very, very special for the future?
Yeah, I think it's a world which is full of content now. There's a lot of content. We're saturated with it, which is a great thing. But at the same time, I think some good content may just get buried under not so good content. and that's a challenge. Though things, I'm a cynic, so I'm trying very hard to sound positive as I say all these things. I'm going to pick my words. But the tools exist now. We don't need those fancy cameras for someone just to tell a story in their backyard. Phones are more than capable of telling a story. Today morning, I shot this grasshopper jumping off my thumb with my phone at 480 frames per second. Like, if someone even told me that was possible 5 years ago, I would have said, no way. That's only meant for big budget guys like, you know, BBC or whoever it might be with their Phantom Flex cameras and stuff. But here a phone has it. So we're not limited by tech in that sense. The big guys, and I don't think I'm in that big ticket stuff at all. It's an illusion I've created. But the really big ticket stuff, I think they're still, it's a different game, different planet. It's in that, multi-million zone. And the decisions are taken with a different motive, I think, at that point, at that level. Having said that, there is a market for, or an audience for, hard-hitting, honest, straight content like the Green Hub films, stories told by people who are, who the stories belong to, really. And I still feel, that's the best way. Even as a filmmaker, I would rather someone tell that story rather than me go and embed myself and say, oh, look what I found, oh my God, the whole presenter-led thing. I think that's kind of done. I don't know if the television market has changed that or is willing to change that, because that's something that sells, and that you see that in shows like Bear Grylls and any kind of presenter-led show that you have is something that we've all got used to. We expect that almost to happen. So it's about changing tastes. It's about developing an audience and kind of going with the flow and seeing, okay, they want to be entertained, so let's entertain them. Let's do shorter format. Let's not go on about a point, because people are very perceptive now. They know, within a sentence and a half what you are really trying to say. We just have to try and make them care enough. I don't know if I answered your question, but
no, You did, Gautam, because it is to understand. We are running into our 5 o'clock closure. So I'd like to ask the Alt-F team, is it okay if we take it? Are people okay with taking it forward by 10 minutes or so? Is that all right? Okay.
We can stretch ahead for, I think, 2 to 3 more minutes, but then we have to start wrapping.
All right. Thanks. So, Gautam, so thank you for that. And I think you had articulated very beautifully also earlier when we were speaking about big ticket broadcasters looking at somehow romanticizing nature films and what you put very iconically as the pretty foot versus the real foot, you know, where you put forward the pretty foot. And and that came through very clearly in your 360 shot of the snow leopard. And there was that other reverse truth of the 360 shot of the garbage. Yeah. So so it's amazing, and all three of you are such a tremendous resource, and I'm sure sorry there's such a shortage of time that we have to wrap up in the next 2-3 minutes. So I'll leave it to the three of you for closing remarks, because we don't really have time for any specific questions anymore, but I'm sure we'll be able to connect with Alt-F again or any of the audience again and put forward another discussion if there is unsaid stuff. But I leave it to three of you to just end with a closing remark each. One focusing on filmmaking and the idea of whether it can be sustained in the future, like independently, do you vote for it as a tool for environmentalists? I think it's come through very, very strongly. But what would you have to say in today's day and age for young filmmakers who are stepping out? What would you want to say to them? Just closing remarks. Gautam, we'll start with you, and we'll go to Rita and Mandakini.
Well, I mean, if you have a story to tell or something to say, then just start doing it. There is no one way, there is no correct way anymore. And I think the world is primed to, hear things being told to them the way it is. Google 60-second docs as well. So it doesn't have to be a long doc. So 60-second docs is a 60-second doc. It's on YouTube. Check it out. That's it.
Thanks, Gautam. Thank you. Yeah, Rita?
Yeah, I think I'll just add to what Gautam is saying, that filmmaking remains a very powerful tool, and with the platforms are changing. Social media has become a very, very powerful platform for advocacy of promoting the ideas of conservation. So the more stories we have, so it's, you don't have to make a long film. Use social media, use Twitter, use Facebook, use WhatsApp, use all the platform, Insta, and you can really be part of changing the whole narrative around development, you know, changing the paradigm, the definition of development, and which moves more towards a balanced world. And I think we really need to do that post-COVID. We really need to do that if we have to look at a future. And I think the young people who are picking up the cameras somewhere, I think, can make that difference. So not to let go of it and follow your heart if you really believe in it.
Thank you. Thank you, Rita. Mandakini?
Yeah, both of them have said what I would have liked to sum up. But one little, I feel the need to integrate filmmaking as a thing in school education. It's a tool for exploring oneself and also for making the children and the growing up mind to be aware of media awareness, how the same story can have different angles. So it's not the ultimate truth, because although the film as a medium, whatever it shows, it seems like real. It goes into the minutest details. But what is left out, what is unsaid between, and as it is, an image can be interpreted in so many ways. So let this generation become little sensitized to the medium from the point of view of the person who's, and not be just passive recipients. So it is very necessary, even as a filmmaker, to understand the audience. How is it? How are you conveying? What are you trying to say? And your story is from your point of view. It's not the ultimate, to generate that dialogue. Otherwise, we are just preaching, or we are preaching to the converted. What I feel, all the environmentalism, what Gautam, so it's true that half the time we go to film this thing and we are preaching to the converted. We need to go to the masses. We need to go where action is required. because how will otherwise we preserve the last remaining vulnerable pockets of forests if we don't train the villagers? They are the stakeholders. So that's where the importance of film medium comes. Let them use it, let them get sensitized, let them, I think that's all.
Thank you. Thank you, all three of you. It's been fantastic talking to you and really, really so many insights, such experience, so much of vision. And it's great that we are all being able to come together like this. Thank you all, Tef. And thank you all for your time. Thank you, the audience. I now hand over to Francesca to wrap up, and hopefully we'll meet again, and all the best to the ALTEF Film Festival as well. Thank you, everyone. Francesca.
Thank you so much to all of you. That was such an amazing and insightful conversation. And what I really enjoyed was hearing some of your ideas on how we can also push the boundaries of how we make and also view films. With that, I just have a few things to say. Just another reminder on the deadline for submitting your films is coming up on the 15th of September, so that's 9 days from now. And also, I wanted to share this roundtable discussion that we will be opening up, which is a safe and alive platform for people in the film industry and film enthusiasts to actually go a little bit deeper and talk about some of the issues that the industry faces, especially with concerning the social and environmental side of things. So we actually want to hear from you as to what topics would be of relevance to you for these roundtable discussions. And so we're sharing a link to a form in which you can share more about your ideas. Aside from that, if you would like to be stay tuned to some of the future events and also more updates regarding the festival, you can find us on Instagram at alt.eff, that's alt.eff, and also on YouTube and Facebook. If you want to catch the live recordings, you can find us if you just type in All Living Things Environmental Film Festival. I'm also going to share again the links that our panelists shared during their presentation. For those, there were many questions about, you know, seeing those links again. So yeah, that's everything. And thank you to all the attendees, for the many of you signing in from wherever you are, and also for your questions. And please, follow us, yeah, if you like this event and would like to find out more about our pre-event schedule, yeah, just follow us on our social media.
And also, Francesca, I think there are some questions, detailed questions about equipment and permissions and filmmaking technical questions for our panelists. Perhaps you could curate those and forward them on email and post the answers somewhere where your viewers can access that, yeah?
Yeah. Absolutely. I think what we can do is actually list out all the questions and have them answered by the relevant panelists. And then maybe we can share them on our stories.
Can we request one thing? For all the technical questions, you could comment on our most recent post, and that way we'll have them in one place and then we can just respond to it in an email. Because once we end this meeting, we won't have access to each of your questions. And this meeting is going to end in about 2 minutes. So I don't want to miss out on your questions. So please just post comments on our last post, and we'll answer them.
Okay. Thanks, Nehan. Thanks, Francesca.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ALTEF.
Mandakini, Gautam, and Rita. And thank you very much, ALTEF, for bringing us all together. And thank you, audience, for watching. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 Bye.